Saturate my soul, yeah. Come on, let it rain. can do without it. We need it. Oh, yeah, yeah, yes. Sing the rain.
Help me welcome our pastor back. Give her a hearty amen as she comes.
Amen. Do not stand. Do not stand, please. Don't stand. She don't like to be stand.
Yes, I'm back. Yes. It's good to be here today. God has been good to me. And I'm sure he's been good to you or you wouldn't be here. We're so grateful for his blessings, for all that he can do for us. He can reach out and touch your life in a way that nobody else can do it. And I'm thankful for the past 3 weeks of having time to take off and rest a while. And did I miss you? No. But I think if I asked you, did you miss me, you would say yes. I have time to be away and take a moment and reevaluate everything and where I've been and where I'm going. And it's a blessing to be in his house again. It seemed like a long time and yet a very short time. But we're happy because God is good to us and he's brought us from such a long way, and he didn't have to do it. We didn't have to be here this morning. We didn't have to be alive. We didn't have to be well. I'm thankful for that, for all that he has done. It's a blessing to be in his house again. Yes. But I am thankful to God for letting me stay home and listen to his voice without interruptions. Oftentimes, when you try to get along, you have interruptions from one thing to another, but thank God for 3 weeks of no interruptions. He has been good. He knows how to bless you. He knows what to do for you. But I was walking around the house one day. Hi, Jeremy. I'm going to see you right after this. Listen, I thought about when I was walking around the house, the Lord said this to me. He said, and they call me Lord. And what I heard in that, you have the nerve to call him Lord. But the scripture says, why call him Lord, Lord? And don't do the things that he says. You know, every one of us, we don't want to be referred to or treated a certain way, because if you haven't treated me right, I want you first to go back to where you need to go before you start calling me Lord. But, I mean, that's everywhere. People, Lord, have mercy. Lord, this and Lord, that. Oh, they'll do that. Oh, my God. Oh, Lord, have mercy. We use it all the time. But the fact is, this morning, if I can get nothing else across to you, let me get across to you. Do you have the right to call him Lord? Because he said, if you don't do what I tell you, I'm not your Lord. You may say it, you may say this and say that, but I'm not yours. I'm telling you, hard sinners that never serve God, don't pray, don't go to church, don't do anything, have the right to say, Lord, have mercy. Let me tell you, that is unbelievable. You got to first understand what it means to be Lord. See, you can't claim him as your Lord and neither your master, unless he is in control of your life. Now, nobody can tell us that more than you can. Is he in control of your life? Or are you still doing things the way you want to do it, how you want to do it? Then he's not your Lord. If you're still walking in a sinful path and you haven't surrendered your life to God, he's not your Lord. You must understand that. have to be Lord, he has to have absolute control. Absolute control. You say, well, yeah, I do. I ask the Lord things, and I do some of the things he wants me to do. He said, you got to do it all. You got to do it all. He is Lord only if he owns you. He's got to own you, not you own you. He's got to own you. And then you have to understand, you got to honor him. How do I honor him? By living my life and giving my life to him. That's how I honor him. It says, and love him more than anybody else in the entire world. You know how many people we say we love, and I'm telling you, and we wrap ourselves up in them. We say we really love these people, but we don't wrap ourselves up in God and say we really love him. He's looking down at this situation. Don't you get it wrong. He's looking down at it. You know why? Because he sent his son to die for you, to give you a chance that you never deserved. And now you want to call me Lord, but you want to walk all over the cross, all over the shed blood of Jesus, and treat it like it's nothing, and I don't really want to be committed to it. You say, I'm not your Lord. So I thought I better let you know that this morning, he ain't your Lord. Think about it. Listen to this. When I went to the Bible dictionary, this is what it says about him being Lord. First of all, it's a Hebrew term of Udon, means ownership. It means absolute control. It is applied to God as the owner and governor of the whole earth. Also used as a term of respect. I respect him. I'm careful how I walk. I'm careful what I say. I'm careful with the places that I go. I don't want to say I'm a Christian and you see me over here drinking booze. I don't want to say I'm a Christian when I'm Saturday night. I'm in the club. Oh, no, no. You say, well, I don't think there's nothing wrong with it. Hang on. You'll see what's wrong with it in a minute. You won't find Jesus in the club. So who did you go see? It wasn't him. Okay? He says, but, okay, Lord and Master, to whom a personal thing belongs, the one having a disposition of men or prosperity as the Lord of the vineyard. He is Lord of the vineyard. He has complete control because the vineyard belongs to him. And so he says, I told you to go into my vineyard and work. You're still sitting around. You ain't did it yet. But if you're going to call me Lord, you got to do what I told you to do. Because if you don't do what I've said to do, you're not mine. You're not mine. See, the term Lord and Master is a title of honor, expressive of the respect of reverence with which servants salute their master. You know, many years ago when slavery was full-blown in this country, those slave masters, they owned these slaves. And they did everything that they wanted him to do. If he said do this, do that, they did it because they were a slave. The Apostle Paul one time spoke of being a slave to Jesus Christ. That simply means he has control. No man on this planet should be a master to you. The only one that should be a master is him. And because he loves me, the person who was willing to give their life that I might have a right, the person who said, Father, prepare me a body and I will go and I will be the sacrifice. Yes. Yes. So I'm looking at that thinking, okay, let's take a moment and check ourselves and our life and say, you know what? I've been calling him Lord for a long time, but in actuality, he's not. I never thought of it this way. For you to even address him as Lord, you're going to have to serve him. That means when he calls the shots, you move. You don't do anything unless he tells you to do it. You don't go any place unless he tells you to go. So think about it. So now, as I looked into this, it says the title is also applied to Jesus as the Messiah. And by his death, he acquired a special ownership of man. And after his resurrection was exalted by a partnership in the divine administration. So now, after he gave his life for you, see, that was a price he paid for you. You're no longer your own, but you're bought with a price. So you don't belong to yourself. You may think that you do. And you try to take control of the wheel, and you try to do it your way, only to find out you're on the wrong road, and you missed the wrong turn, and everything in your life is in a mess because you didn't let him drive. Let him take control of it. You just get in the back seat and don't tell him how to drive. There's nothing worse than somebody that can't drive sitting in the back seat telling you what you should do. I said that to my husband when he was driving around, and I'm sitting over in the passenger side, and I'm saying, honey, why don't you do this? Why don't you do that? And he said, Rose, I'm driving this car. And I need you to shut up. You can't even drive. Just be quiet. Now, why are you doing that? Why are you doing this? I mean, the bottom line is that I didn't really know how to drive. I'm trying to tell him what to do. And that's where a lot of people are with God. They don't know how to drive, but they want to tell him what to do. See? Now, when I went out to try to learn how to drive, my husband was in the passenger seat. Now, he should instruct me because I can't drive. So he says to me, adjust your rearview mirror. Okay, I can do that. Then he says, adjust your side mirror. Okay, can you see? Yeah. Okay. Then he says, now, when you're driving, Rose, you're going to have to glance in your rearview mirror, and you got to watch your side mirror. I said, you can't do all that at one time. Yes, you are. You're going to watch that, you're going to look side mirror, and it just becomes just automatic. When I'm if you know how to drive, you're going to check your rear view, you're going to check your side, and you are going to still look ahead. You can do all that. But man can't drive. He's still trying to run the show. You still to tell God how to do it. You don't know how to drive. You don't know what to do with your own life. You think you got the answer, but you don't have it. And so every day you get up saying, I'm going to do this and do that. You ain't going to do any of that. You don't know what you're doing. You sit sometime, you look at man, and you think, how stupid are you? Did you actually go down that street? Did you actually do that? How stupid are you? You applied the brakes when you should have applied the gas. How stupid are you? The bottom line is, I can't drive. We need to get out the driver's seat and say, God, take over and let me get back here. Let him be Lord. Let him be Lord. When I went down to take my driver's test many, 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 many years ago, and the man sat on the other side and he just observed me. He had a tablet, a little clipboard, and he was checking me off. I didn't know what he thought at the time. Did I make a bad turn? Did I do this wrong? Did I do that wrong? Or what did I do? You don't know what you did wrong until you get out. Once you get out and go back in, he said, well, you flunked. These are some things you didn't get done. This is what you should have done. This is where you should have turned. This is how you should have done this and done that. That's exactly what God's telling us. When you get through doing your thing, okay, get out the car. I don't know why God let my life turn out like this. You know, I thought God was going to do it. Look, he said, I'm not the Lord yet. Don't blame me for your mistakes and the things you do wrong until you understand, until you make me Lord, you're going to keep doing things wrong. He has special ownership of you. Resurrection sealed it. Stop for a moment. You know what? I'm glad that he's driving. I'm glad he's my Lord. Because I can't even tell you what a mess I made of my own life. Because I thought I could do it right. I thought my grandmother was so old and back in the tutors, she didn't know what she was talking about. Yes, she did. I thought I knew. It didn't take me very long outside the house to find out she knew what she was talking about. Yes. Now, Webster Dictionary put it like this. One having power and authority over another. And I was surprised that he said Jesus. I was surprised that Webster done that. I expect that in the Bible dictionary, but not in the regular dictionary. It says Jesus, a leader who has preeminence, to whom service and obedience are due. See, he's got deliverance. So he's taking care. He's taking care of everything because he's number one. I turned my life over to him a long time ago and said, now, God, I can't do this. I've tried it already, and I still can't get it done. So I'm coming to you to ask you to help me. Now, when it gets in the driver's seat, don't start saying now, maybe I should remind you that right down here, I usually take a right turn. You're not taking a right today. Sometimes when I get to this point, you know, I just want you to know these are some of my markers that I had along the way so I know how to get back to where I'm going. He said, I don't need you to tell me where to go. I don't need your instruction because you have proven that your instructions really stink. They really stink. Don't even go there. I want to instruct him. Too many people won't tell God how to do it. That's why we don't get many things answered from God, because we want to tell God how to bless us. How to take me to over here. How to open this door. And God, this let me tell you, I know you know. Well, if you know he knows, then you need to shut up. See? He says, a leader who has preeminence, to whom service and obedience are due him. You're serving him. He's not serving you. See? It says, one who exercises that. You got to let him exercise it. Every time he try to get you right, you say, well, Lord, I think I better get back in the driver's seat because I really wanted you to be Lord. But, you know, I mean, I just don't go down this road, a street called straight. I'm going to take you over here to straight. You say, well, I'm going to straight because you ain't learned yet to walk straight. You haven't learned yet that I am the Lord and Master. I made it. I do with it as I will. I don't need you to tell me how to do it. I've never seen so many people in the church who thinks they know how to tell God what to do. Well, the way I feel, let's not go there. The way I think, let's not go there. Because you're thinking and what you're doing is all screwed up. Let's not go there. See, he says, master's one having authority over another also, one having control, having chief authority. I mean, he's at the top of the list. So whatever he tells me to do, I'm going to do it. So when they begin to talk to Jesus' mother at the wedding and said, we're out of wine, she said, whatever he tells you to do, do it. You ain't out of nothing if you do what he says. Because I am the provider. I am the one that makes it happen. I'm the one that can do it. Got to let him do it. The reason why you're not, your life is not good, you ain't letting him do it. Well, I went to church. I joined the church. I'm not talking about joining. I'm talking about hooking up with Jesus, repenting of your sins, saying, come into my heart, and I want you to work a work in me, and whatever you tell me to do, that's what I will do. I didn't come in trying to tell God, you got some nerve. I'm the person who created you, who made you, who knows everything about you, understands and knows every thought before you even get it. And you're around here telling me you need to tell him, the God that spoke things into existence, with just let it be, and you think you can tell him? Oh, we need to wake up. We need to wake up and realize it don't work like that. It don't work that way. He said, now, I'm going to lead you down the road of blessing, and I'm going to tell you what it is. I've set before you this day a blessing and a curse. Your life can be blessed or it can be cursed. Now, I'll tell you how to get the blessing. And that is, if you do what I say, then you will be blessed. But if you don't do what I told you to do, understand. Understand, that's not going to work for you. That's not going to, you say, I don't know why everything went wrong. What did you do wrong? What did you not do? God sent Samuel to Saul. And he told him, when you go down there, I want you to kill everything, wipe everything out. I don't want any of it. It's full of sin. I don't want none of it. He goes out there and saves something. When Samuel comes up, Samuel says, why haven't you obeyed the Lord? He said, I did. I obeyed God. I did what he said. He said, then what's the sound of the bleeding of the sheep in my ear? They're supposed to be dead. See, he says, well, the people wanted to say something. Do you know what, as a preacher, you're not going to get away telling God what the people wanted to do. God told you, I called you to make the call. They don't make the call to the preacher. The preacher hears from God. The preacher gives it to you. That's the way it's got to go. That's the way he set it up. So if you want to be blessed, you got to do what he says. You can't call him Lord until you do it. See, of course, if you don't obey, he says, I'm going to curse you. A lot of people throughout this city, throughout the world, are living under a curse simply because they didn't do it God's way. You got to do it his way. And that's where the blessing comes. You can't do part of it. You got to do all of it. Otherwise, it doesn't work. It's a tragedy. How long that God has waited on man to get it together. Get it together. I've given you chance after chance after chance to do it my way. What are you doing? Why are you not over here by now? Why are you not there by now? You're not going to do it that way. Well, I think there's some things I know God did give me five sisters. He's in control of them. Yield everything to him. Everything. Everything that you think you know, give it to him. Everything that you marked along the way, give it to him. He said, I'll change everything. You know why some people get saved and never really get saved? Because they still got their own way. You can't do it. I remember I told my husband one time, I said, honey, you got to ask the Lord to fill you with the baptism. And he said, he was raised in the Methodist church and didn't know about the baptism and speaking in tongues. And I said, ask the Lord to fill you with the Holy Ghost. He said, well, it's okay if I speak in English. No, it's not. Why would God have to do something for you and teach you English? You already know English. No, but that's the point that I don't really want to let loose and let somebody have control. The reason why a lot of people don't ever receive the baptism, they never let loose. Let him do it. You think you got to come up with a tongue? I kid you not. No, you don't. All you got to do is wait on him. Wait on him. He's going to do it right. They call me Lord. Every day they walk through life talking about the Lord. You get on the bus and somebody will tell you about the Lord. You go to church and they will sing about the Lord. Don't even know who they're singing about. Don't even know who he is. Never had an experience with him yet. Help us, Holy Ghost. When I think of that, I think, oh, you're a bunch of rubbish. Be quiet. What you're talking about makes no sense. If God didn't give it to you, it's crazy. Because the stuff man can come up with is amazing to me. I've often said to myself, how did you do that? Well, my mama tried it. We're talking about God being in control. We can't pattern our lives after mom, dad, sister, and brother, and friend, and boss, and all this stuff. He says, I want to be in charge. Oftentimes, we put too many people in the car with us. Too many people. And everybody's talking about something. And everybody's got an opinion. And everybody's going to tell you what they think it should be happening. How you should do this. I don't think you ought to have done that. I think you should have done it this way. You don't tell God how to do his business. After being a pastor for, my God, 35 years or more, you always have people who think that if I was Sister Rose, I would do something. I'm not asking you. It's one person who's got to instruct me. One person who's got to tell me what to do. One person that I don't do it wrong, I better listen to him. Because you start listening to man, you're going to be messed up. You're going to be confused. You're going to be in a fix, trying your best to find your way. And don't listen to the input of people. Everybody's got an opinion. Everybody can tell you, well, I think it'll work this way if you do this. Listen to what God is saying. He'll never take you wrong. This is what he says. He said, I have spread out my hands all the day unto a rebellious people, which walketh in a way that was not good. He says, and their own thoughts are messed up. They think wrong. You know how much trouble you can get in just with thoughts? You know how many bad mistakes you get in because you thought? There is a way that seemeth right to man, But the end thereof are the ways of death. And a lot of things don't look like it's all right to you because you can't see. You can only see what's here. You cannot see what's out there. That's why you got to listen. Say, Lord, direct me. Order my steps. Show me what to do. Tell me which way to go. Tell me when I should get up, when I should sit down. Tell me, God, direct my life because I've tried to do it. I made a mess of it. You hear people say, boy, they got everything going for them, but they got one thing missing. And that's the direction of Jesus directing your life, telling you what to do. Because man's got his own plan, and his plan is always about him. It's always about him. Think for a minute. Say it one time. You call me Master and Lord, and you say, well, so I am. If you do what I say, I'm your Lord and Master. You understand who I am. It's just that you ain't gave me no control. The reason why you could be way down the road doing something totally different, I mean, sitting on top of the world, so to speak, but you chose not to do it that way. Live your whole life, become an old person, and still ain't got nothing done. Think about it, because you didn't let him help you. Sometimes I look at people and I think, boy, if these people, they're young now, and youth has its drawbacks. Because youth makes a lot of crazy decisions. You got to mature. You got to grow up. And say, you know, I really don't know. Can you tell me? Pride prevents man from letting God take control. Let him take control of your life. He'll fix it. You made a mess of it, but he'll fix it. He'll do something with it. He said, I spread out my hands to a rebellious people. I don't want. Which walketh in a way that was not good for them. I stretched my hand. I said, come here, don't go down that way. I know, this is good. I know my mama walked this road for years. Where is she today? Where is she? You must understand what road one person walked may not be the road you're supposed to walk. We're all different people. We're uniquely made. We're all different. See? He said, they want to do it their way. They're so rebellious. They, when you try to tell them to do something, they're just stubborn. I told a man in this church, I'll leave nameless. I said, you have fasted, and you ain't no better. In fact, every time you come off a fast, it gets worse. I said, don't, you just need to get on your face before God and say, Lord, you know what? Here I am, fix me. Fasting is not doing one thing for this fellow. I told him, I said, now when you go home, get on your face before God and seek him. The average person in this church would love for me to say fasting ain't helping you. They would love that. But you tell this man it's not helping you. You just fast, and get worse. What is that? You know, he went right on home. He ain't got on his face. Start fasting again. It doesn't work. At some point, you got to make a decision. If I'm doing this again and again and nothing is happening, something about this is not right. Because people fast for many reasons. It's not the fast that God ordained for us. It's all about your flesh. It's all about feeling good. And you feed it and you feed it and you feed it. Follow some instruction. How hard is that? My son David's learning that. David said, Mama, I look at these people and I think, it's simple instructions. What's the problem? I thought you learned that because you didn't always do that. You learned that. You got to understand that if we're going to call him Lord and he's controlling our lives, that love will let you say, I'll let you have it. I don't know what to do. I've tried it. I talked to another person before I got off of vacation, and I said, and this person says to me, I'm going to change if I look like a skeleton. I said, you've been looking like a skeleton for 40 years. Now, is that not going to tell you that ain't going to help you? You just be an ugly skeleton. It didn't change nothing. You're the same person 40 years later, and you think, if I look like a skeleton, and still disobey. still don't follow instructions. Simple, simple instructions. Not complicated. We make it complicated because you know what? We want to show God for all these things could happen now, Lord. You know that, don't you? You know that if I do this, I might be in a bind. I can't imagine what God's saying. I can't imagine when he's looking down at you explaining things to him. He don't need your explanation. He already knows everything. Why you got to explain it to him? Listen, it says, he told Isaiah, this is a rebellious people. Lying, L-Y-I-N-G, lying children. Children that will not hear the law of the Lord, which say to the seers, to the prophet, to the preacher, see not, don't tell me anything bad about me because I don't want to hear it. I just want to know what this spiritual place I got with God. No, 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 no. Get a grip. A lot of people can talk in tongues. Don't mean it's God. The devil's got a counterfeit for everything God has. See? Don't see nothing. That's what the people telling them to the prophet. Don't see nothing. Prophesy not unto us right things, but speak unto us smooth things. Prophesy deceit. Don't tell us nothing. Nothing like that. People really like me until they get to know me. Then she will tell you the truth in spite of it. I care about you. You say you couldn't prove it to me. The way you was looking at me this morning telling me. No, I do. I care. And the person won't tell you the truth, don't care about you. Sister Rose, just tell me I'm okay where I am. I'll tell you that if you are. But if you're not, don't expect me to lie to you. See? He said, if they be willing and obedient, they shall eat the good of the land. But if not, they will be devoured with the sword. If they be willing and obedient, they'll eat the good of the land. Good things will happen to you. You know, a lot of bad things will happen to people based on one fact. They didn't do what was right. If they done what was right, it wouldn't be there. See? Now, you got to have it. You can't even get into the kingdom without doing what he says. You can't do it. He says, into God's kingdom, if you're going to get into the kingdom, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven. Call him Lord if you want to. That don't mean you're going to heaven. Oh, we seem to put everybody in heaven. You know, whether they're liars, cheats, drunks, drug addicts, whatever. Well, he's looking down at me. No, he's not. He's looking up. He's not looking down at you. Nobody's in heaven. He said, they call me Lord, Lord, but they don't do what I tell them to do. So he said, so everyone that call me Lord doesn't mean I'm their Lord. See? I told my oldest son there was a, basically a disgrace to our family. Used to be a preacher. Backslid, hoed around with women and done all things that was bad. I put him out to church in 2000. It's 2016. He's still out and he's still going to stay out. And so one day he called the church line and left a message on the line. Some message he left. And I told Daisy, I said, well, call him, put him on the line. She put him on there, and I said, hello. He said, Mama. I said, hold up. Don't call me Mama, baby. I ain't that. You can call me Sister Rose, and that's an honor. Mama? Mama means I didn't hurt you. I didn't disrespect you. I didn't break the laws of God. I didn't commit sin in his house. You don't have the right to call me Mama. That is an endearing word. You call me Mama when you've been good, when you've done what you should have done, I'll take Mama. Until then, Sister Rose is good as far as you're going to go. I was shocked. I said, you call me Mama? Are you kidding me? I'm not your Mama. See, everything that gave birth ain't your Mama. I gave birth, buddy, but you ain't mine. I mean, you were so crooked, I wonder sometimes, did I get the wrong kid out the hospital? But you can't claim me as Mama till you get right. And then you got to prove yourself. Prove yourself that you are really changed. You really are different. Otherwise, don't call me. No. You say, well, that's a cruel thing to do. But that's because you don't know what to do. See? It works. It works. See? Everybody that said, Lord, Lord, is not coming into the kingdom, but he that doeth the will of my Father, that's the ones coming in. The ones that's living right. The ones that give their whole life to God. The one who quit the sinning business, turned their back on it, and made up their mind they was going with him. That's the person who's going to heaven. Not these people who walk around saying, honey, I love the Lord. No, you don't. How you love him if you ain't doing what he says? Mm-mm. Don't work like that. See? Stop for a minute. Ask yourself, is this not the reason my life took a bad turn? A bad turn. How is that? Because at some point in your life, you took the wheel and said, I'm going to drive this car, and I know what to do with it. But in actuality, no, you don't. You don't know what to do, but you think that you do. You know, you've seen all of us when we're growing up, we think we know everything, though our parents tell us that that's not what it is. We tend to believe that they don't know what they're talking about. I know. I was the same way. Thank God for salvation. My baby was little. I can't remember which one because I had seven. So it's hard to sort out sometimes. But all my kids, I recognized something in them. They were wanting to do something before the time for them to be able to do it. I can walk, Mama. I can walk. And you ever seen a baby start walking and he's wobbling like this and then all of a sudden he gets in a fast pace because he's getting ready to fall. He can't control it and stay back here and put one foot down. All of a sudden, he goes doing this. And all of a sudden, yeah, I told you couldn't walk yet. You learn how to crawl. You listen to mama. One day, my son said to me, one son or daughter once said to me, mama, can I carry your purse? I said, you can't carry it. It's too heavy for you, sweetie. I can carry it, mama. It's too heavy. But I can carry it. I said, here. He just started going forward with the purse. I said, I told you couldn't carry it. He thought he could. I can do this. No, you can't. See, I know when the time comes for you to move on your own and you've been strengthened and you've grown up and you've matured, I can stand back a bit, but you ain't there yet. And God said, look, I'm trying to help you to get to a place that you're not there yet. Stand these people who got a revelation for God and still drinking milk and have a pacifier. I got a revelation. You know, my Lord was talking to me. You don't even know his voice yet. Teach my lambs, my sheep, they know my voice. There's a difference in a lamb and a sheep. That's a baby. This is a mature sheep. My sheep know my voice. A stranger they'll not follow. Listen. You know, I don't have any reason not to tell you something wrong. I gained everything by telling you what's right. The word says you must obey from the heart. From the heart. Not just, I'm going to do it. She told me to do it. So, you know, I'll go ahead and do it. Though you're doing it from your heart, I want to do what's right. I'm not sure what right is to a point, but I want to do what's right. So I listen to somebody who's been there. Somebody who's been down a road that you haven't been down. We don't like to listen. We learn by experience. The things I thought I knew when I left home, I realized I didn't know nothing. I was as green as an onion. I mean, my mind began to reflect back on my grandmother and things she told me that I thought she didn't. She don't know what's going on. She back in the tubies, child. She don't understand life. I think by 70-something years old, you start understanding life. Because, of course, you still have some old fools that have made it that far in life. It's still crazy. Still crazy. You know, it's bad for you to die an old fool. You expect a lot of young people to be stupid. But an old fool, been around a long time, is still crazy. Let's say, God, when I leave from here today, I'm going to let you direct my path. And you say, well, I really mean But I mean, when I got out, he ain't gonna tell me that, you know, you can't go down this road. I've been traveling this road for the last 5-10 years. He said, don't go down that road no more. That's why you're still nuts. You've been going down that road 5 or 10 years. That's why you're nuts. So don't go down that way no more. That's why you haven't changed. That's why you're the same person. You ever seen these people, women and men alike? Women and men both are attracted to a certain type of person when it comes to the opposite sex. Now, what is it about these fools that if I was attracted to this man who beat me up, blacked my eye, bust my lip, knocked me on the floor, and then all of a sudden move on and see another one that reminds me of him and say, he reminded me of my first. You better run. You better, did you learn anything from that? Did you learn something? If he reminds you of that same person you just left, is that not a red flag flying over your head saying, get out of here? Or do we stay there and do it again? Help us, Holy Ghost. Then men that like to control everything, they look for weak women. The scripture calls them silly women. So they look for those kind of women. They spot you out. You're weak. You're a yes person. Whatever he says, you say, okay. He says sit, you say, where should I sit? He says stand, you say, over here. Okay, everything he runs the show, you have nothing to say, nothing to do. Listen to what he says, because he knows everything. See, the one who thinks he can control everything, he thinks he knows everything. He doesn't. See, you quickly have to learn in life. Either I'm going to be a strong person or I'm going to be a weak one. But if I attach myself to God, if I let him into my life and into my heart, then I know without a doubt I got a good place to go. I don't have to worry about it. We get caught up with people and they want you to believe that they know everything, except they don't. No person on the planet knows everything. The only person who knows everything is God. We need to take orders from him. What do you want me to do? What do you want me to say? Jesus said, come here, come here. I'm going to try to give you a good husband, a good wife. But Lord, I don't know about him, but I know you. I know you. I know what you're looking for. I know what you need, because I made you. See, if we go out here and buy a car, we buy a Buick or Oldsmobile, whatever, and it needs fixing, your best is go back to the dealer, to GM who made the car. Because some of these mechanics that you run off to, they don't know nothing about them cars. You say, them dealers run you, cars, you, man. Not all of them. But then you go get somebody that says he knows. He look under your hood and say, what's this? He asking you the question. What's this? Aren't you supposed to be telling me? Are you supposed to be telling me? You ask me what that is? I said, I made it. I know who you like. I know what you would do. I know how you think. I know your makeup. I know that. So I'm trying to help you. Because, see, I know when I created you, you was a fool. We're some of that. We're some of that clay that he's trying to work with, and the clay keeps bubbling up. And he bring it, and he mash it down, and he do this and do that, and it just keep bubbling up, and you go say, lay down. I'm the potter, you are the clay. You're in my hands to do with as I want to. Just lay down. Take it. It may not feel good, but take it. You're going to be better as a result of it. I'm trying to control your life, and sometimes I got to beat you across your head with a bat before you get it. But that's not, I told the Lord, this is not me. I just see God looking down saying, you're going to tell me this is not you? I know you. I know you very, very well. Knows you better than anybody on the planet, more than your husband, more than your wife, more than your mom, more than your dad. He knows you. Stop for a minute. I said, Lord, you know what? I'm so tired of trying to do things myself. I'm so tired of trying to think I know it all. You know, when Peter was in the boat and they was trying to catch some fish. And the scripture said they toiled all night long and they still didn't get any. And the Lord said to Peter, cast your net on the other side. But Peter said, Lord, we done toiled all night. Why do you have to answer God? Why don't you just do what he just said? Well, you toiled all night, you didn't get nothing, put it on the other side. Well, Lord, nevertheless, at your word, we'll go ahead and put it over there, but I'm a fisherman, and there ain't no fish biting out here tonight. Turn it, put it on the other side. See, man don't want to be told what to do. Because Jesus ain't no fisherman. I mean, this is my life work. I know what I'm doing. There's no fish out here tonight. We done toiled all night. How many people in this room, you done toiled all your life and getting nowhere? You can't get a bite no matter how you try. And God said, put it on the other side, put it on the other side. When he raised it up, it had so many fish in it, it broke the net. They had to ask for some more people in another boat, come over and help us. We got so many fish. That's why you ain't got so much of everything. Because when God tells you to do it on the other side, you show him where it doesn't work. Yes. He don't need somebody who thinks they're smart. Because those are some dumb people. He don't need anybody who thinks, well, I got my degree. I can't use you. Because you don't teach God about your degree. The wisdom of this world is foolishness to me. I don't need to hear from you. You need to hear from me. See? So look at your life. Yeah, you know, I started out trying to do. You know, with Sister Rose was preaching that message. I thought, well, Lord, that's my problem. I need to let you ride. When I leave from here today, I'm going to change things. I'm going to say, God, you get on the driver's seat. I'm going to get here in the passenger seat. He says, get in the back seat. Well, Lord, I'm used to riding up front. I can see better up here than I can in the rear view passenger seat. Get in the back. I still want to sit up in the front. Jesus, wait a minute. It's a red light right there. Well, hold on. Wait a minute. We supposed to turn right here. Get in the back seat and shut up. I don't need you to tell me how to do it. I'm God. Just do what I tell you. You'll always come out ahead. It may not look right. It may not seem right. You may think this ain't working. Don't worry about it. Do what he says. It works. No matter what. I was telling Lamont this week when they went to Washington, I said, quit assuming. Well, I thought, Mama, if we'd done this, that this probably would happen. I said, don't assume. This is a God thing. Walk in it. I think they're going to get upset. Walk in it. They ain't going to like it. Walk in it. I thought they may think this. Walk in it. And every time you put the assumption down, you feel like you know what's going to happen with this. I can tell you right now that this doesn't work. And you run into your friend and say, you know, if I were you, I wouldn't do it. The Lord told me to do it. But if I were you, they don't know who he is. And you claim you know him, but you listen to other people. Say, I want to help you get through this. Let me be master. Let me be Lord. You want to build a business? Let me build it. Let me build it. Now, you're going to have to do this. It's surely going to be something you don't want to do. I guarantee it. You're going to say, I was planning on doing such. God said, I don't care what your plan was, do this. Your plan is mas nix. It's nothing. Your man makes the dumbest plans. And then sit there and tell him, no, I thought sure that would work. If you just listen to God, listen to him, it will work. I can tell you it'll work. See? By faith, Abraham was called to go out into a place, obeyed, and went out, not knowing where he was going. Well, you know, God's going to give me a little more instruction here. Now, he's telling me to leave my mama, my dad, and all my kin folks and just leave and go out there. And I don't know where I'm going. Somebody meet you on the road. So where are you going? I don't know. Man, you better have some kind of plan. I don't know. God's got a plan. He went out anyway. No, we got to figure it out first. You tell God, well, Lord, did you know they're building a bridge down there on Fillmore? You still want me to go that way now? They ain't finished yet. You still want me to drive over? Yeah, drive over. I just got my mystery. I don't know. I don't feel too good about that. And then drive down to the bridge and look at it. You know, this thing could fall. Everything man makes could fall. What am I going to do? I'm going to drive across it. Because he told me to go across Fillmore. Yes, it's the road. I know that's what we're supposed to do, but when I saw how that thing looked, and I went to talk to somebody, and they told me this, I said, Lord, have mercy. Yeah, and then they come back to me for counseling. He says, well, could you counsel me? What about? You know, I came to you the other week about such a thing. Yeah. I said, well, did you do what I said? Well, not yet. See ya. See you. Don't have time. If you didn't do what I said, I don't have time. You're wasting my time, sweetness. Get lost. Don't take up my time. I said, you know, she just is rude. I ain't rude. I'm not rude. I told you a story about my son, David. He was a little boy. And he, in Germany, when we were in quarters, housing areas for the military. And the quarters were kind of got a lot of wind in around the windows and stuff at times, so the heat wasn't good enough to keep things hot, so we opened the oven up and let the door stay open and let that help to heat that part of the dining area. And so I said to David, he was in there, he was fascinated by that red coil running down around the bottom. He go look at it. I said, don't touch that. That'll hurt. Look at it. He go back again. Something about that red light up like that. And I said, David, don't touch that. That will burn your hand. I think he's about 4, 3, 4. Still go back and look at it. That's just what y'all do. Jesus said, don't bother that. That'll burn you. One day I was sitting in the dining room because the kitchen's on this side. I'm sitting at the dining room table. There's a wall there. I hear this blood-curdling scream. Now, mother knows the difference between I want some attention or I just hit pain or something is badly wrong. Immediately when I heard that scream in my head, I thought, he touched that. Oh, mama. And it was burned so bad it was all white. He cried so pitiful. I wanted to help him. I wanted to take away the pain, but I couldn't. Okay. He healed from that. They put some kind of ointment and stuff on it, and it helped him a lot. And so I left the oven door open. I was in the kitchen. He comes in. He said, he said, hot. Yeah. Hurt, mama, hurt. Yes. I didn't have to watch him or nothing. Hurt. And that's kind of the way God got to let us get the message. Let it hurt because you're not listening. You're not listening. He says, I told you don't do that. I know from experience that's hot. It will burn you. But you said, well, you know what? I'm just going to touch it a little bit. I'm not like I'm going to hold on to it. God help us today. I am probably more tired in the ministry telling folks the same thing over and over and over again. Did you get it? And they just kind of push it away and kind of be nonchalant about it and don't worry about it. I'm not going to worry about it. And they go and do their thing. And I think you're going to run into trouble. But see, the problem is you weren't designed to drive. Listen. The 21 in some will get you in trouble. You don't tell me what to do, honey. I'm 21 and some. 21 and stupid. I ain't learned nothing yet. Elijah comes unto the people and said, how long halt you between two opinions? If the Lord be God, follow him. If Baal, then follow him. And the people answered him not a word. Telling us if God be God, follow him. like you turn off a radio station. Just reach up there and turn it off. They ain't heard nothing else you said. And you say, you should have listened. Do you remember that? Do you remember what I said? See? I told my kids, I said, the Lord brought to me about what I just told them this week. I said, I want us to have y'all to have a journal. I need to leave some things in place for y'all because y'all going to say, I never heard Mama say that before. And the Lord told me the other day, he said, I got them. I got them right here. You gave them to me a long time ago. Don't worry about it. Don't concern yourself with it. Because most of the things I'm going to say to you, you already got it. It's whether you follow it or not. And you know if Mama was here, she would not go for that. Honey, things change. You might be a fool if you want to. Go ahead and be a fool. Go ahead. See? It says, for the Lord is my defense, and the Holy One of Israel is our King. He's only your defense to protect you if you do what he says. Don't call me Lord. Don't think I'm going to be there in time of danger if I'm not Lord. Because you're in danger because you didn't listen to me and let me drive. See, we think everybody else knows. It's amazing to me how we think everybody else knows, but God don't know. The one who spoke it into existence. They that trust in the Lord shall be as Mount Zion, which cannot be removed, but abideth forever. As the mountains are round about Jerusalem, so the Lord is round about his people from henceforth and forever. And I got him around me to protect me. I don't have to worry about anything because the angel of the Lord, it camps around. Ain't no angels around you while you're doing your thing. Somebody told somebody one time, said, you're on the highway driving to me. I asked the Lord to be with me. Are you breaking the speed limit? He's not with you in your wrong. Go ahead, keep speeding. See the sign, speed limit 65. I tell you what, speed limit years ago used to be 70 miles an hour. They brought it down to 55. Man done 65. They brought it down to 65, he does 75. He's never content. Did you get it? So what's the speed limit? 75 miles an hour. Look over at this speedometer. It's 80, 85, 90. You say, do you know what the speed limit is? Yeah, I know, but I'm careful. I'm going to be careful. They want these cars that you put the pedal to the metal and just go down the road at a very high speed and then wonder why you was folded up in the jaws of life, pull your tail out. You say, who was that? Oh, that's one of Sister Rose's members. I knew it was her because her head was out on the street. He that knoweth to do and don't do it, to him it is sin. I better pay attention. I better watch this. What is this? Listen. He said, Lord have mercy. Head in the street. The Lord is righteous in all his ways and holy in all his works. The Lord is nigh unto all them that call upon him, to all that call upon him in truth. He will fulfill the desire of them that fear him. He also will hear their cry and will save them. The Lord preserveth all them that love him, but all the wicked will be destroyed. Those that love him, those that let him be Lord and master. I'm taking care of you. When danger was coming your way, I saw it and I offset it. Because you called me Lord. Not only did you call me Lord, you let me be Lord. You're sitting here this morning saying, you know, Sister Rose, I never thought about that. I mean, I use that saying a lot, Lord this and Lord that and God this and God that. And I never thought about, well, are you really in control of my life? And you can ask yourself that in a few seconds and say, no, he's not. You know he's not. Think about it. What are you going to do with it? I'm going to make a change. I'm going to do what he says. Even when I don't understand it, even when it's not clear to me, I'm going to make a change. And you can. So this morning, while you're sitting here listening to this, thinking, that's why my life is in shambles. That's why everything keeps going wrong. Because I'm doing the driving. I'm not listening, paying attention. Maybe I need to change that. I changed it 50 years ago. And I can tell you my life has run smoothly since. I don't do anything without directions. Anything without guidance. Tell me, God, should I go this way? Should I preach this? What should I preach this morning? There were 11 messages on the shelf for these preachers who don't have one. 11 messages on the shelf that I worked on the last 2 days. Which one do I preach, God? Thank you for the message, what it's for today. They keep saying, they call me Lord. They don't do what I tell them to do. Let them know, unless you obey, unless you do what I told you to do, I'm not your Lord. You can't expect anything from me. You cannot quote the scripture to me. You cannot say, God, this is what you said you would do. That is, if I'm Lord. If I'm master, that applies. But if he ain't Lord and master, don't try to hold God's word up to him because he ain't thinking about you. See? Take a minute. But time trouble come, and we made the mess. Then we're saying, I just asked him, please help me, God. Please. Please have mercy. Have mercy. You know the chance. Are you going to walk with him or are you going to talk about it? It's one or the other. This morning, while musicians and singers are coming forward, think about it. So I got to think about that. This message didn't come for nothing. God knew you was going to be here. And he's saying to you, I want to change it for you, but you got to get out the driver's seat. Don't slide over reluctantly. Jump out. Don't go around to the passenger side on the front side. Get in the back seat. I can't see things good back here. You don't need to see nothing. Everything you saw already is a mess. It's a mess. Think about it. Your life can change if you'll let him do it. You've never experienced joy and happiness until you say, God, I'll do it your way. First of all, you need to come to him and acknowledge that you're a sinner. Lord, I know I'm a sinner. I need you to help me. I tried doing it on my own, but it's not working. So what can I do? He says, come to me. I'll make it right. I'll give you power over sin, power over all these things that have kept you going the wrong direction. I'll help you out. But if you're not serious, if you're not sincere about letting him lead you, going nowhere, think about it. So I want to change that and get my life together and do what he tells me to do. While our musicians are singing, are playing and singing, singers, if you want prayer this morning, say, Sister Rose, I've been driving this thing all my life and I'm in a mess. I'm soon going to be out of this world. I still ain't got it straightened out. I still can't get it right. He wants to help you. While they sing and play, if you would stand, you'd like to come forward, please do. God bless you.